in the position, I think there'd be a strong want for that potentially. If that focuses the spotlight on what the future might look like, then that'd be useful for consideration. But is there any vision at the moment for that?
Okay, all right. So thank you. So this is what came out this morning as well. So the governors are going to look into, come next September, creating year five and six together. Our proposal so far has just been to create year five as the current year four move forward, and then the year after create year six. But the feedback that came back earlier today was that there might be an appetite for those 2 years to start together. Could be two separate classes, could be a combined class. I'm not surprised, because I've had contact from people living in Potton who have been saying to me, well, we want to be part of this. You know, we're prepared to, we've got year four children at the end of the first school in Potton, and they would like to be part of this system as well. So I'm not surprised to hear there is a demand. So that is what the governors are going to have to look at. Now, obviously, from an educational point of view, and speaking as an ex-teacher, moving a child into a new school 1 year and then moving them back the next year is potentially disruptive. But obviously, you know, you have reason for doing that because you want to guarantee a particular pathway. So I think the things that the governors are going to have to look at is about ensure, you know, putting something, perhaps working with Comberton, so there is something that's in place which would allow children to stay at the village college until the end of year six, so do 2 years there, which has got to be much more stable for them, and then allowing them to transfer over into Comberton. So I think there's a number of options there, and I don't think there's any answers, but I think the fact we've got those questions, and the governors are seeing that there is an appetite from you for them to find solutions, is really, really helpful.
And so if that outcome is the main goal, and then you at least have the choice of option A, B, or anything else as well.
Exactly.
But on the thought that certainly the end result being the desired outcome. Then
there's a number of ways to skin a cat.
The issue is also about everyone saying, oh, there's a decision, and then what happens after this decision? There's one of those chicken egg situations where a consultation process like this occurs, and was even this evening. That's Stuart's little party trip. So Stuart. process is, as we're already finding out even this evening, that until we have these question and answer sessions, we don't fully know exactly what we can do. There's a situation where a decision is made based on responses we get, and even at that point there are still many other hurdles and questions and ways of actually solving providing the solution and actually changing the age range when it happens, the speed at which it happens. So even once a decision is made, in whichever way it's made, therefore there are still many other questions that can then be answered, but also other questions that will come up. And of course it's the GFS parents here that we need to actually be able to find out what your requirements are and how that process should develop once any decision is made. Is that fair to...
Can I just ask, sixth form provision, have you got the capacity to take our children as sixth formers? Because that, for me, I have a 16-year-old who stayed on at school, but there's so many children staying on at school now, there aren't a lot of sixth forms within Cambridgeshire. They've got to go to Cambridge, and getting there is a complete nightmare from this village.
Yes. Yeah.
So have you got the capacity when our children are
to take them
in your sixth form?
The sixth form obviously is a further and a freer market, that's the right phrase to use. I mean, you know, youngsters are at liberty to make choices depending on courses, outlets, all the rest of it, and move around at that point, even if you've got a sixth form in your own school, and youngsters for various reasons will make that choice for different sorts of reasons. So there is movement now, and there can be movement right now. People make those choices right now if they want to do that. The sixth form was opened 4 years ago and was built in the first instance for 350 sixth form students. There's just over that number now. It was actually built with very, very good premises and good, very good accommodation for that numbers. Fortunately, went through at a time when such funding was still being approved for those sort of developments. We're confident that clearly we could take at least 400 sixth formers with the accommodation that's there at the moment. If there is to be a decision, and we're to admit further than that, which there's clearly demand for that, then again there are processes that can be gone through with funding applied for an expansion of a sixth form provision with sixth form specialist facilities, which there is provision within legislation and funding available for good and successful sixth forms, similarly as there is with 11 to 16 schools as well, to provide some further capacity should that be needed. So if we got into that situation, then we would look seriously at developing some further specialist sixth form facility as appropriate. The other thing that's true is that even with admitting the sort of numbers we're talking about in the year groups coming through, where there's about 70 further places out of catchment at the moment, which obviously would be highly significant for year groups feeding through at a younger age group. Of course, actually, Comberton Village College was expanded to permit 300 per year groups come through when Campbell was there in years 11 to 16, ages 11 to 16, years 7 to 11, and therefore, given that we haven't actually knocked any classrooms down since, that there is another mechanism that could use some capacity if it needed to. Again, we want to develop that in an appropriate way to be sixth form specific. That could be possible. There's actually two ways that if the sixth form was to go beyond 400, and clearly there was demand for that, and we could appropriately cope, that we would be looking to develop facility further to allow further expansion. So, yes, and that definitely could take place on the school site.
Would you like to talk a bit more about the sixth form? Because it's quite sure. it's quite a new sixth form, and you know, obviously, you know, it takes time to sort of embed and become successful. Did I give a bit of some information about the sixth form?
Until 2011, Comberton Village College was an 11 to 16 village college, as with most others, but because of having hit certain performance criteria, government legislation at the time meant the school was literally written to and said, are you interested in the possibility of opening sixth form provision because you meet certain performance criteria and legislation says you can do that. Launched a consultation, the general feeling was it would be helpful to develop some more sixth form capacity to the west of Cambridge, not in Cambridge for the sorts of reasons that have just been said, and that led ultimately to the sixth form being opened in September 2011. At the last full blown Ofsted inspection that the village college had at Comberton in 2013, one of the particular reasons for that taking place at the time was the new sixth form. That was looked at, the provision was judged to be outstanding there within its first 2 years, along with the general provision in the rest of the school. And actually, results in the sixth form have improved further still since that judgment was made. And we are obviously getting good numbers, it's becoming a popular choice. It's mainly A-levels, but we also offer several BTEC level 3 routes through as well. So we try and provide appropriately for a significant swathe of students. Not all, those that want particularly applied courses, more vocational courses, we can't offer the right facilities, so that, you know, we're not going to try and offer things that we can't do well. But it's there, and the very significant majority of students are progressing through to university courses, very often to selective universities. But there's other routeways through that youngsters are taking as well if they don't want to go to higher education. So very quickly, that's the sort of profile, and that's where we got to at the moment with the sixth form.
Thank you. Right. Yes,
sorry,
come back.
Sorry, how will your panel members change in the sixth form when the first sixth form start building from Cambridge Village College? Will that increase those numbers and then reduce the initiative you can take from your fields?
Again, there isn't is a proposal to replicate a sixth form provision at Campbell Village College, because actually to make sixth forms work really well these days, you may well be aware that funding at sixth form level has been squeezed quite a lot, and you need good numbers in sixth forms both to make it financially viable and also to offer the breadth of curriculum that anyone might want. So obviously, you know, people from there can apply to the sixth form competent, and equally they can apply to Cambridge at sixth form college. colleges or wherever else they might want to go, and the numbers feeding through. They've got to remember it's a sort of gradual effect, because at the moment you've got the larger year groups feeding through, they're in the upper year groups anyway, they've got Campbell children involved that are feeding through now. It's just in the sense that Campbell children will be taken away from the other year groups. So the actual increase in numbers when Campbell Village College children reach year 11 is not as large as the numbers that are there, but absolutely it is part of a general ongoing increase in numbers that are coming through from that way. And the two mechanisms to expand the capacity of the facility I talked about earlier would need to be looked at if we were really clear that those numbers were obviously going to go well beyond 400, and we felt we could properly accommodate those youngsters, and there might be very good reasons for doing so. We would develop more facility and pursue the mechanisms to bring in the funds to enable that to happen.
And there's fund developments to squeeze those
sixth
form funding.
Yeah, but for good and successful sixth form provision, that is one of the top criteria for accessing the capital funding that's available to academies through central government. And also, we could be looking at some of the classroom space that, even with more catchment children potentially feeding into the lower year groups, wasn't all needed just for lower year groups, if we were confident that that could be used in the appropriate way, adapted to be absolutely what you want, especially for sixth form facility.
Thank you.
Yes.
So
I think you spoke a lot about capacity and competence. My question is about capacity of this school, because with special growth development ongoing, I also think if it goes ahead and we align with Comberton, I think we'll attract a lot of families into the village to get into the catchment. And is there a risk then the families within the village end up not being able to get space at this school because it's full, because there's obviously only so much space
at this school? Okay, all right, well, I'll answer that in part, and then I'm going to hand on to you. So, yes, we are taking growth in Gamlingay. You have to realise that when you take housing growth, the County Council ensure that developers make serious financial contributions to key services, such as education and health, and to the Parish Council for things like play space, and to themselves for transport, in order to mitigate for the impact of that growth. So Sebastian and I have been sitting in meetings recently about the proposed 30 houses down the bottom of Mill Street. And the County Council have worked out how many new children that could potentially mean for this school, for the Village College, for Stratton. And then they assign a formula to that, and they work out how much money needs to be handed to this school for, there's a project for this school anyway, for two new classrooms and a big extension to the hall, so towards that project, which have been kind of on the cards for a number of years now, and similarly contributions to the other two schools, if they are deemed not to have capacity to cope. So, you know, there is always money comes with it. You don't just get kids foisted on you without the money to allow you to accommodate them. But if I talk, let Mrs. Desborough take over.
Absolutely, and that's where, so when we're thinking about, when I said the county had already come out, already assessed what the capacity we have already, I then have undertaken a feasibility study. As Bridget said, there's already plans that have been in the pipeline for 3 or 4 years that are drawn up. They would obviously be revised, but if there was a need for this school to grow, there is the ability for this school to grow with building work.
And imagine the school being able to cope. And I think I actually feel that I've been a real advantage with the small class size, mm-hmm. because I feel my children have the education and the attention that they needed. With the larger class sizes, I think potentially that can impact on the education of our children.
But that's where we would work together, you know, if we joined the Comberton Academy Trust with the governing body to ensure that actually we're catering for the needs and we are maintaining the educational standards that we currently provide, and making sure that we are still doing that if our numbers increase. And what are we going to do about those numbers increasing, and how are we going to best provide for the children? Because we're all here because the children are the most important things, and we won't let that.
So one of the other things, I've learned a lot about academies in the last few weeks, and one advantage is that it actually frees up quite a lot of cash, which would have been spent on maintaining the buildings and running your procurement and your IT, and frees that up to be spent on education. So education can mean people, because actually your most important educational resource is your is the staff, be they support staff or teaching staff. So by being an academy, there's more money for that. And also being an academy gives a school access to capital funding for building, which is virtually impossible for non-academised schools to get. Yes?
The mechanism for applying for capital funding is certainly clearer and with clearer criteria, and it's true that, for example, Comberton Village College has got quite a lot of money that it hadn't succeeded in getting from the capital side, over £2 million for absolutely properly required developments, both to capacity, particularly in a particular area of children provided for who have particular special needs, and the fact that the roofs needed replacing, as did the heating system, various other things, unless that was done soon, but there was no mechanism that we were able to pursue, were able to apply through the scheme, and those things have been sorted out in the last couple of years. So yes, in practice, what you say, I can give examples.
Can I add to that? In addition to that, if it's identified that there is a need, so the money that can be applied through being an academy can be used for a variety of purposes. So as Mr. Mundy's already said, you know, actually improving your existing facilities. If it's identified that there is a fundamental need for additional school places and there is not the capacity, even though you are no longer a maintained school, the county also has an obligation to provide those places. So they also will have an obligation to contribute finances in order to make sure that there is enough places for the children within that need to be educated within a village. So, as well as anything that may come from any Section 106 building, you've got money that can be applied for through being an academy, and there is also an obligation on the local authority as well to make a contribution to that.
So, and the other, just as a sort of external observer to this, though I appreciate that small classes are lovely and they're very nurturing, they actually mean less money. They're, you know, they're more expensive. So, you know, if your classes are small, you're getting less income, and at some point you have to then make the decision about do you merge two classes in order to save the salary of a teacher, and then you end up with a, you know, a smaller pool of expert teachers and a bigger class. So, you know, there is an optimum size for classes. I don't know what it's considered to be at the moment.
Numbers we've been given here. If you look at Sandy Upper School, it's actually only got half the role that it should have, but the results are really good. So what we're showing you is that those small class sizes have a positive impact on the education.
There's undoubted action, and I think that typically fits in for older children, actually. Certainly, you know, I wouldn't be happy if my current sixth form was being taught in classes of much over 20, actually. So yeah, it's a very valid point. But, you know, you have to weigh up the economics of it, really.
Absolutely. And I was just going to say, I'm just going back to what's best for the children, and I think if we keep that in mind, then as we just said, there's an optimum, but there's also that idea of what we can provide is the best that we can provide with the money and the children that are in the
class. And you potentially have more money to do all
that. It is something that the governing body, over the last number of years, have been very, very conscious of, and truth be told, the governing body have fought very hard and managed its budget very, very carefully in order to make sure that we have enough funds within our budget to maintain eight classes. Because actually, probably for the last 3 years, we shouldn't have had eight classes because of the number of children in the school. We should really have gone down to seven classes before this point. But as a governing body, we've made a conscious decision that actually we didn't want to do that because we wanted to, for as long as we possibly physically could, keep the eight classes and keep our class sizes smaller and more manageable. However, unfortunately this year, it just wasn't possible. If we'd have maintained eight classes, we would have put ourselves in financial difficulty, and that wasn't something we were prepared to do. So unfortunately, we had to go down to seven classes. So it is something the governing body has been very mindful of for a number of years.
Would you like
to ask a question?
Yes, please. We talked a lot about money, finances, logistics, all that stuff. Can we
get back to education briefly. So looking at the stats, the school, Comberton is doing incredibly well. What you've got children of all different abilities in that school, very large numbers, averages, you know, say what they say, and you've got big numbers behind that. So what's the philosophy behind that that you would be applying to our children if you let them come into your world?
That's quite a big open invitation. I believe that the most fundamental thing to excellent school is excellent people working together. Now that's an easy thing to say, but it is absolutely getting high quality people into every single position and then working effectively together. And absolutely, that's what we're looking to do with this school, certainly working together, thinking about, I mean, one of the things that you can do, and I think actually managed to do since being a trust, is recruit some really outstanding practitioners who really like the idea, the possibility of not just working in one school. Some people really, really just want to work in one school. That's probably just as well. We can't have everyone zipping around everywhere all the time. But there are, and I could give examples of some of the people in recent years who joined because of that possibility that sort of they find challenging, professionally enriching, and interesting. And I think tied in with that also is we've got a very strong involvement in running a lot of our own teacher training programs as well. That's both primary and secondary. And we have partners that we're running School Centre Initial Teacher Training Programme with that significantly developed its primary arm as well. Now again, obviously in terms of what matters most, ongoing recruitment of the very best teachers, clearly running your own teacher training programmes and having access to those people when they're trainees, should they come in, having your own staff working with those trainees and alongside that actually develops the staff in schools themselves and they find that very stimulating, brings new ideas in. It's working in those sorts of ways that over a period of time, I'm convinced, and governors and trustees have been, because they've sort of backed it as an approach and we continue to do that, but